Lynn Hiles Ministries presents That You Might Have Life.
He said he didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might have life. So Jesus came that we might have life. The Bible said in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The more light you have, the more life you're going to have.
So you can have peace. Was only, that's why it's called the gospel of peace. He took your punishment so you could get his peace. He took what you had coming so you could get what he has coming.
All around the country and around the world, people just like you are awakening to the good news of Jesus Christ.
What God wanted to do was release the kingdom of God in your life until the joy and the peace and the righteousness of the Holy Ghost would so fill your life. I don't want to just make heaven my home. I want to make my home like heaven.
And now, here's your host, Dr. Lynn Hiles.
Thank you for joining us again this morning on the program. You're going to be blessed again by the Word of God. I've got two very special guests with me again this morning, and I would encourage you to grab your Bible and another cup of coffee. You don't want to miss this. I have on the set with me my oldest brother and his wife, who are both pastors of Chapel of Praise in Wofford, Pennsylvania. It's a great privilege to have you guys on with me this week.
Thank you
for joining us. Jack has been a guest with me before on the program. So this time I thought I would ask Lola to take first chair, so to speak. And Jack's welcome to jump in as he wanted to. But if you have been watching us, we've been featuring the last couple of weeks. My sister was on, and there's some powerful women of God out there that are unsung heroes that I think the world needs to hear what they have to say. Before we went on camera, Lola was sharing some things. This is Lola. And my brother Jack, I mentioned his name, but this is Lola, and she is Jack's wife, and they pastor a great church in Wofford, Pennsylvania. If you're in that area or you're viewing this in the viewing area of Hancock, Maryland, Hagerstown, Maryland, Pennsylvania area, you owe it to yourself to go by and be in one of their services. You'll be blessed by the gospel that's coming from their house. So if you're viewing us on cable in this area, then you ought to go by and hear that. But before we came on camera, Lola shared a thought with me, and I'm just going to introduce it, let her take off, because she really is a powerful woman of God in her own right. But she was sharing a scripture out of Genesis where God began to speak. It said, "And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make a helpmeet for him." And, you know, she was sharing with me, and I'll let her, she can explain it probably far greater than I can, because it was her thought, that what God was articulating in this scripture was more than just, let's just make Adam a helpmeet. Really, right. The heart of God is really saying it's not good, not just for man to be alone, it's not good for God to be alone.
That's it.
That's right.
You know, because God has a lot of stuff, but there's a few things that he is, and one of them is love. God is love. And if love unexpressed is inadequate, it's incomplete. So God really was showing not just the fact that Adam needed a helpmeet, but there was a greater, far greater picture that's been represented here in the very heart cry of God to have someone that he could have relationship with. So you were sharing some powerful stuff before we went on camera, so just take your time and share it there.
As I was sharing with you, Brother Lynn, we were headed to South Carolina the other week to do a conference with Pastor Randy Lambert, to do a woman's conference. And my heart goes out a lot of times to women, because sometimes we've been, like you said, the underdog, but we have been in the backyard waiting for our chance to declare. And I heard God specifically say, you know, I'm God all by myself. I don't need any help being God. I know who I am, mm-hmm. but I have a need. And I have a need for a bride mm-hmm. who knows who she is, who can stand up, who can declare, who has confidence enough, but yet humble enough to present the Word of God. And I'm not just talking about a female. I'm talking about the church, the bride of Christ, because that's what he has called us to be. And when I read that scripture in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18, it was not Adam declaring that he needed someone. At that point, I don't know that Adam actually understood that he needed. He was in the middle of naming the animals. He was in the middle of being set into a garden, into a finished work, into a perfect place. He looked around and he said, I've heard you preach, Brother Lynn, and say, you know, God said, name him Adam. And he said, he looked over and he saw a rhinoceros and he said, That's a rhinoceros, and that's what he called him because that was his nature. But in the midst of that, the Lord begins to look around and he begins to realize he's created somebody to walk beside the tiger and the lion and the bear. They have their mate, but there's nobody for Adam.
Yep.
And he said, it is not good that man should be alone. And when I read it, my heart began to stir within me because I didn't just hear Adam's cry, I heard God's cry.
Yes.
As he began to stand up and say, I need me a bride. I need me somebody who has confidence
yes.
enough to stand up in this day. And I said, but God, how can we? Because the church has been so alienated, even from you, God, that they don't know how to come into relationship with you. We can't possibly reproduce if we're not allowed to come into your courts. And I thought about the lame man who sat at the gate beautiful. The scripture declares that he was lame from his mother's womb. So at some point during that birthing process, that mother, that church, that bride, something happened in that process that created this man to come out lame. The Old Testament declares anybody with a defect, a deformity, has no right to enter into the congregation, to come in, to be a part, to have any part in this house. How could he get there? And as I began to read that scripture, I began to look and I began to see as Peter and John began to walk in. And I thought probably that lame man that had laid there all those years waiting outside of a gate that they called beautiful mm-hmm. must have been a beautiful place, must have had a glory about it. But something was lacking that he couldn't go in. And as Peter and John approached him, he thinking that he was going to receive the same thing that he had always received, began to beg alms. And we have put people outside that gate
yep.
and made them beg for a place in the house of
Come
God.
Come on, preacher.
Yes,
and when they lay, thinking that today is going to be the same day like it
same
was yesterday. But Peter and John, I think they had probably come into the force of their ministry because they began to almost like they shook themselves and they realized what I have is not any silver and gold. What I have is not the usual. It's
yep.
not going to be what he's looking for. And they said, we don't have any silver and gold, but what we have, we're going to give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. And I believe the woman of God, the church of God, the bride of Christ that is standing up is going to begin to stand up and say, I don't have what you think you need, but I have what you really need.
Yep.
And that is that you need to rise up on your feet and walk. And when I ministered this in South Carolina, I ministered it personally to some people, but I hear it for the bride of Christ,
yeah.
that it's time that we shook ourselves and realized. And then again, I think about all those people who are so intimidated because they've heard of a wrathful, vengeful God. And I wonder, how did we ever come up with that concept?
Yeah.
When I realized that, as you said, as we started this program, God is love. The most powerful force on the earth is the power of love.
Yeah.
And a God who would look down, and before I ever knew I needed him, before I ever knew that I was lost and undone and a sinner, died for me, created a plan to make sure I had redemption from every curse and everything that would ever keep me, that would stop me from having life,
mm-hmm.
redeemed me from that curse.
Yep.
Put the curse in reverse and said, I've come to give you life
yep.
and that more abundantly. How could he not possibly want me to come into his house?
Yep.
How could there ever be a separation? Because the scripture declares that there is nothing that can separate me from the love of God. But we've set up walls, and the church has done this.
Yep.
The church has created that wall that says, I'm sorry, that's as far as you can go.
Yep.
You have no right here. You're unclean. Get your tag out and wear it proudly
mm-hmm.
because you're unclean. But I beg to differ with you because I have the seal, the stamp of the approval of God. Because
yes,
in Ephesians, he begins to declare, and he said, I'm going to wash you with the water of my word.
Hallelujah.
By the words that I'm going to begin to declare, I'm going to begin to speak into your life, and I'm going to create, because Isaiah declares and says, my maker is my husband.
Yep.
So when he put Adam to sleep in Genesis chapter 2, and that word sleep means he became old and wore out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was at that point that Adam, he became so sluggish and he began to realize he couldn't do this by himself.
Yep.
God even created a
yep.
need in Adam to know that he needed a woman
yep.
because God had recognized his need. He said, Adam, you have a need. You have a need for a helpmate to
yep.
stand alongside of you. And while God is God all by himself, He also needs a church that enfolds and recognizes that there are so many dying and hurting people, so many people who have been sold a bill of sale that says you're defective and you are of no use in the house of God. And those are the very ones. David himself made an army out of a legion of men who were downtrodden. They were in debt, outcast.
Yep.
And he looked at him and said, these are the ones. And when they stood up as an army that could stand before any foe and stood beside of David as armed men ready to go to battle. And that's what God's looking for. Absolutely. When he washes me with the water of his word and he begins to speak into my life. And I thought about the scripture in John that talks about, I think it's chapter 10, he said, my sheep know my voice, mm-hmm. and another they will not follow. And the problem has been, we've listened to so many other voices besides the voice of our husband.
Yep.
The voice of our husband has declared us to be. Because in Ephesians, when I was talking about how he said the washing of the water of the word, he said, and I will present her to myself.
That's good.
The problem has been, we've been trying to present ourselves to the world.
Yep.
The world can't see what God sees.
That's right.
They can't see as God sees. But he said, I'm going to present her to myself as a bride, mm-hmm. as washed, fully clothed, fully ready. Isaiah also declares, and he says, I've been as a bride adorned. He's clothed me with garments of righteousness. And I got to thinking about how, in another scripture, some of my favorite passages are Isaiah and St. John. Mm-hmm. And he begins to declare, he said, the effect of righteousness is quietness and peace, mm-hmm. and a habitation of rest. Mm-hmm. What a better place to minister from than that place of rest where we find it. And you can only find it if you keep listening to the shepherd, mm-hmm. when you hear his voice, mm-hmm. when you respond to his voice. Because I'm not going to follow another voice, because mm-hmm. it'll destroy me. It'll tell me my faults. But my heavenly Father, my beloved bridegroom, who's adorned himself and who has dressed me,
yep.
and washed me, looks at me and said, you're just who I called you to be.
You know, I was thinking while you were saying that too, the basis upon which he says that. I was thinking while you were saying that, in Genesis it said, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon
Adam. Deep sleep.
You know, in another garden, 4,000 years later,
yeah.
Jesus is on Calvary's cross.
Yes, he is.
And he cries out, it is finished. And when he does, he goes into a deep sleep, so to speak.
Yes, he does.
And the side of Adam was opened in Genesis, and a woman was brought to him.
Yep.
But on Golgotha's hill in another garden, the side of Jesus was opened by the spear of a Roman soldier, and blood and water came out. And in Genesis, it was the rib of Adam that produced a bride. But in John's gospel, it was the blood and water that produces a bride. In Ephesians, where you just quoted from, Ephesians, I believe it is chapter 4, that says that he might wash us by the washing of the water, by the word, that he might present us to himself a glorious church, not having spot, wrinkle, or blemish, or any such thing, that may not be just something that he is going to do, but something he did at Calvary,
yes,
so that my acceptance and him receiving me and not seeing me as crippled, not seeing me as full of spots, not seeing me as something that's not worthy, has all been dealt with, not on the basis of my performance, but on the basis of his side that was open and the blood and water that flowed from that side. God is desperate for a woman.
He is.
What a powerful truth, too, you know, that when we're speaking of this man that's by the gate and has been here and lame all of his life, all every day expecting the same thing, every day seeing the same thing, every day expecting some good person to throw a few things his way to just exist, to just make it, not really to be noticed, not really to stand out, just a little something, and all of a sudden, that change from never being able to enter in the gate beautiful to standing up and realizing a powerful truth about himself, that he was the healed and the blessed of God, and all of a sudden it opened up an avenue of life to him that he never knew he could experience. Yeah. And how long have we, you know, how long have we maybe in our zeal for God kept people in a place of crippled and thinking they're never going to be able to attain and thinking they're not worthy to do this, or they're not worthy to rule. What a powerful truth to release them, mm-hmm. into the love of Jesus Christ, and they realize for the first time in their lives they can walk through that door and be like anybody else in this place and be accepted, not because of what they did, because of what he did.
Yeah, that'll make you walk, leap, and praise the Lord.
That's right.
And come in through a beautiful gate.
And know you have a right to be there.
Yep.
You know, I think about, and you've done such an eloquent job with the Song of Solomon's, preaching it. In the first couple of verses, she cries out and she says, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. Mm-hmm. And that word kiss means to attach, as it, and it means if he would, as if he were to equip her.
Yeah.
And arm her.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not just, you know, and this is how I like to view it. You know, it's not one of those schoolgirl crushes where you pass him a note, do you like me, yes or no, mark yes or no. This is where you attach yourself and you come into a covenant with him.
Yeah.
And you're ready to make a reproduction
yeah.
of who he is. God needs somebody, a receptacle.
Yeah.
He needs somebody who has a womb
yeah.
to receive his seed. When Mary began to receive the seed of God, as she was overshadowed, as he began to superimpose himself upon her. And
yes.
he said he overshadowed her, and the power of the Almighty,
yeah.
and I believe the very virtue, the very essence of God flowed into her,
yeah.
and she reproduced in the earth the very image
Absolutely.
Of God. And God is looking for a church that will allow themselves to say, it whatever it takes, God, because it's not going to be man produced. Because she looked at him and she said, I can't do this. I have never known a man. That's exactly who he's looking
That's
for.
Who he's looking
Somebody
for.
Who's not looking to produce it through
That's
a man,
right.
but that
Say
it'll be
it,
a God produced.
Yeah.
But that word kisses in the Song of Solomon means she attached herself. But something happens in just a couple of verses, and you've preached this, where she begins to say, but I'm black as the curtains of Kedar. And what has happened in the church is we have a desire to be with our husband, but somebody comes along and says, sorry, you're disqualified. That right there disqualifies you for whatever reason. And, you know, we have our list of rules and every church is different. This is why you can't. But she, her desire is to let him kiss her. The word mouth there where she said, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth means as if he were to blow or to particularly, it means to speak. And I thought, my God, you've been trying to speak to me all the time. If I could just listen to you,
yep.
if I would
yes,
listen
sir.
To nobody but my husband, I would hear the words, yep. as they say yep. in the movie, the words that are coming out of his mouth would cause a creation in me that I would know who I was and I wouldn't be afraid. I'd walk in like Esther into that chamber, dressed in my royal apparel, because it's apparel he gave me.
Yeah.
It's apparel. It's my righteousness that he clothed
yes.
me with. It's nothing I've done. It's not of my works. And I think about how people, and I've done it all my life. And I don't know how else to put it except to say, I've served a lot of gods.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not because I've been in a lot of strange religions. It's because I've heard the natures of these gods and I've tried to please them
yep.
with my works, with whatever I could. I have always wanted to please God.
Yep.
All of a sudden I'm realizing it's not about me pleasing God. I already please God.
Yep.
I already stand approved. And when she stood, yes. Queen Esther stood in that hallway, dressed in her royal robe,
mm-hmm.
knowing confidently who she was, that she had come to this place for this time. It was her time to stand up. It's the church's time to stand up
yes,
and
is.
Recognize who they
yes,
are,
sir.
That God wants to be joined with them, not a separated vessel. And, you know, if you read the scripture there in Esther, he talks about how Vashti was in his house, but her party was going on in a separate room, but it was in a different,
yep.
She was all by herself. And I thought of this as I was thinking of Vashti, and I thought, you know, we kind of lay it to Vashti and say, well, why didn't you come when you were called? And what? Maybe, Brother Lynn, maybe the reason she didn't come is because she never felt worthy to come.
Yep.
Because she could only come at the king's command.
Yep.
She could only come if he held out his scepter.
Yep.
She could only come if she met the right qualifications.
Yep.
But now in the New Testament, he looks at us and he says, come boldly
yep.
before my throne.
Yep. Yep.
Because when Queen Esther stood in that court, the scripture said he held out his scepter.
Yep.
That means the rod of the empire.
Yep.
And he looks at her and he said, I'll give you up to half the kingdom.
Yep.
And I got news for you. The bride of Christ has a right to everything that is God's.
Yep.
To use for him to fulfill the ministry. I'm so glad to be part of a ministry that is presenting a God that is approachable, that wants to have a relationship, that isn't discarding me, telling me I'm not worthy, but he stands me up approved.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
While you might not see me in that, with those eyes.
He ain't presenting you to me. He's presenting you to himself.
He's presenting me to himself, and I stand approved. And I love it when Isaiah says, you'll never be called forsaken again. you'll never be called desolate. Wow. But I'll call you Beulah. I'll call you that you're not forsaken, but I've called you and I've made a covenant with you because you're my bride.
That's awesome stuff, man. I'm just, you know, I think that is powerful because I think so many people out there watching us are always feeling like I'm inadequate, never quite good enough, can't quite ever meet the criteria. I think so many times we have looked through the Word of God and what we've done is look for what it is that's wrong with people.
Yep, not approved.
Because we're preaching the wrong man when we do that. We're looking at you. But when you preach Christ and what He did, it lets you draw near with a true heart. I believe it was Esther, wasn't it, that also said, she said, I am going in to see the king, which is not according to the law.
Not according to the law.
Because under the law, you're disqualified. Under the law, like you said, that guy at the gate beautiful is begging for alms because he's really a disqualified
priest.
That's
right.
He can't even make a living as a priesthood because he's been rejected. There may even be preachers, ministries out there, Lola, that are listening today that feel like I've done, you know, I've done blew it. There's no help for me. It's over. I'm done for. And all I can do is hope for the crumbs that fall.
Yep.
But somebody somewhere is going to encounter them and say, you know what? You might have messed up, but you're not disqualified.
That's
because
exactly
God
it.
Comes on the scene and says, the law may disqualify, but I come back on the scene to qualify
I
you.
Have qualified.
And I come to tell you that you can draw near with a true heart, full assurance of faith. Esther initiated something. I believe sometimes it's time for the church to initiate a move towards Him.
Absolutely.
I think sometimes
that's
it's time
good.
For people who are felt like they're rejected to initiate a move towards God. I feel like there's probably somebody watching right now that you think you tuned in today not by accident, because God is waiting on you now to initiate something to reach back out to Him. Because and when you do, you're going to find out this time you're not getting slapped away, you're not getting pushed away, but you're going to see Him hand out His hand to you and say, "Draw near with a true heart,
absolutely,
full assurance of faith." You can come in.
Absolutely. He has declared it. It is in His heart to have a woman.
Yeah.
It is in His heart to have a bride.
It's not good for God to dwell alone.
He doesn't want to be alone. It was never His purpose. It was never His intention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, God could do anything He wanted to, but what He did was create a man and a woman, and He set them in a garden as a pattern. And He said, this is my heart's desire.
Yeah.
This is my heart's desire. And I don't want it just for the exclusive few.
Yeah.
But this is an inclusive message.
Yeah.
This includes everybody. Whosoever will may come. We've sang that song. We've preached, said those words, but we've never really meant it from our heart that we really want everybody to be included, because we have those that we figure shouldn't.
Yeah.
Don't meet our standard.
Until it's us that's in that condition.
Until it's us. And then we realize, would to God somebody would extend that scepter to me. And when He extends it, He doesn't just give us a little place. He gives us up to half the kingdom.
Yeah.
And I love the way when Esther goes on, she is so good. Mordecai has taught her how to use her graces and how to use her charm and how to be subtle in the areas where she needs to be subtle. And she creates that big feasting table for Haman and for her king. And not once but twice. And when she gets done and she has the banquet, she destroys the enemy.
Yep.
She creates liberty for her people.
Yep.
Because she sets them at liberty and says, you have a right to life.
Yeah.
And not just, as your program says, life.
Yep.
That we might have life.
Yeah.
God never came to destroy us. He took away the destruction. He secured all the wrath, took away all the wrath, put it on His Son. And He said, now what I want for you, Thessalonians declares, is that you might have salvation, because I've consumed the wrath, and He's prepared a place. And at the end of the book of Esther, there was such joyous celebration. And when she stands before her king again, he says, honey, what is it now that you want? She said, you know how they slew all those men yesterday, and our people, my Jewish nation, received their liberty? She said, can we do that one more time? And not only that, she said, but you know how we killed Haman's sons, his 10 sons?
10.
The law.
Yeah.
She said, how about if we just hang them? Hang their heads high.
Yeah.
And what God is beginning to declare in the midst of us is, not only have I fulfilled the law, but I want to hang it. I want to nail it to my cross.
Oh, that's good stuff.
But Colossians says, he blotted out all the handwriting that was against me and he nailed it to his cross. And I think when she hung those heads and the law was hanging there for all to see, it was like Jesus saying, I nailed them. And they'll never, ever have the power to destroy you again.
Isn't that incredible? Mm. Man, oh man.
Awesome.
We're starting to run out of time, but powerful. This woman, Esther, did more warfare.
Yes, she did.
With a flirt than she did than she did with a sword.
Absolutely.
I think
she never raised a finger, yeah.
I think that's a key. I think the key today in winning the world and winning those that don't understand where we're coming from is with love. And it's with that tender hand that reaches out, that hand that accepts you, that hand that encompasses you, that hand that encourages you. That's what's going to make the difference.
Yeah. She didn't get in a fight. She got in love.
Yep.
Well, I like that. Hallelujah. She wasn't a fighter. She was a lover.
That's
yes,
it.
And because she was a lover, she turned the nation around.
Yes, sir.
And the king made a decree that the whole nation of Israel, or the whole people of God, that she had come to the king. I believe we're really sitting in a real timely time like
Absolutely.
That right now, when
Absolutely.
It is time for the church to emerge and come into that intimate chamber
yes.
and initiate something towards God that will turn even what's going on in the nations of the earth around. It's going to be because people start
Absolutely.
To fall in love with Jesus
yes,
again.
Sir.
God, it's not good that God would be alone, because it's through
That's right.
His bride that He does what He does. He does it through the church. Wow, what an incredible time. We're about running out of time, but I just want to thank you for tuning in. And let me just say, tune in again next week. I'm going to have Jack and Lola on again next week. You don't want to miss this. You're going to be blessed by the Word of God that comes from them. Let me just take a moment also to ask you to sit down for a moment and write to us. Either you can do it via mail, you can do it through our website. You can go to www.lynnhouse.com. You can go to the number on the screen there. We really would like to hear from you and where you are viewing the program at, so we know where we are being the most effective with our airtime. If you're watching the program and you're enjoying it, please contact us and let us know. We're not trying to do that just so we can get your mailing information. We want to be a blessing to you. If you'd like to be part of this kind of ministry and you want to partner with us, we welcome that. It is what enables us to be able to take the gospel around the world. And if you sow a seed in the ministry, one-time gift, or if you want to do it as a monthly gift, we just say there's several ways to respond. There's somebody standing by right now at the phones. We can take credit card or check. God bless you for tuning in. Tune in again next week is our prayer.
Thanks for taking the time to join our broadcast today. This program has been made possible through the generous donations of our partners around the world. If you'd like to partner with us, please send your tax-deductible gift to Lynn Hiles Ministries, P.O. Box 127, Great Kekapin, West Virginia, 25422, or call us at 1-304-579-5336. Also, you can visit us online at www.lenhiles.com to view the large selection of books, CDs, and DVDs we have available. And until next time, remember, in Christ, all of God's promises are yes and amen.